Hey everyone, today we're talking about the most volcanically active body in our solar system, Io. So first I'll introduce what is Io, and then how Io formed and differentiated in terms of its layers and interior structure, how Io is heated, how it can stay this hot even though it's pretty far out in the solar system, its interior structure and volcanism, in which we'll talk about the crustal structure and composition that affects the magma composition, volatile content, and how that affects eruptions on Io, hotspot eruptions on Io, and different eruption styles. And then we'll talk about the possibility for life on Io, which might sound unlikely since it's just a big ball of volcanoes, but you'd be surprised. So stick around till the end. So first, let me just introduce that Io is one of the four largest moons of Jupiter, collectively known as the Galilean satellites. This includes Io, Europa, Ganymede, and Callisto. And active high-temperature volcanism has only been observed on two bodies in our solar system, and that is Earth and Io. But what is Io's magma or lava made of? And to answer this question, we need to first ask, what is Io made of? And to answer that, we need to first ask, how did Io form and how was its composition differentiated in terms of what's closer to the crust or the outer surface of Io versus what is at the core? And so therefore, we can understand what the magma or eventually at the surface, the lava, is made of. So how did Io form? Well, the formation of the Galilean satellites remains pretty uncertain, but it's thought that gas and planetesimals accreted from a sub-nebula that had formed around Jupiter during the solar system's formation. So I talked about how the solar system and our moon formed in the formation of our solar system and moon video. I think that's what it's called. And I'll link it up here if you want to check that out. But basically, there was a huge nebula of material surrounding our sun when our solar system was forming, and Jupiter was so large and had so much gravity and pulled in so much material that it formed a sub-nebula of orbiting material around itself as it was forming, and these gas and planetesimals accreted to form smaller bodies that orbited around Jupiter, eventually becoming the satellites. And these satellites internally heated as they compressed under their own weight. And they also underwent heavy bombardment in the early stages of their formation and lifetimes, where impacts would have contributed to their heating. But why hasn't Io's heat dissipated over the billions of years that have passed since its formation? For this, we need to talk a little bit about more long-term heating processes that might be occurring on Io and other satellites. How do we figure out how Io is heated? Well, first we look to Earth. One long-term source of heat for Earth since its formation has been the decay of radioactive isotopes. And radioisotopes on Io have likely contributed to its long-term heating, but estimates of Io's heat flux indicate that radioisotopic decay is not enough to account for Io's immense amount of heat today. And since Io is so far away from the sun in the solar system, it can't be as heated as a body like Earth is by the sun alone. So we have to look to other sources of heat. One major one is tidal heating. I talked about tidal heating in the Europa video because Europa, just like Io, is tidally heated. And this just means that the gravitational pull of Jupiter on Io deforms it enough to internally heat Io. And Jupiter is actually not the only thing that gravitationally pulls on Io. The other Galilean satellites, like Europa, Callisto, and Ganymede, also pull on Io. We can see the arrows here indicating the pull that those other moons have on Io. And we can see in this picture, at this point in their orbit, they are pulling in different directions on Io. So they're not always pulling in the same direction. And this causes Io to have an elliptical orbit, or what's called eccentricity. And this eccentricity further squishes and squashes and stretches Io during its orbit around Jupiter, as well as its resonance orbits with the other Galilean satellites that also pull on it and pass by Io and pull it in every which direction. And all of this pulling on Io results in immense tidal stress and immense internal heating. But to understand how this heating manifests as volcanism at Io's surface, we need to first understand what Io is made of and how its material is structured internally as well as externally. So based on moment of inertia and density measurements of Io, its bulk composition is dominated by iron and silicate material. But to understand what the magma and eventually the lava that reaches the surface is made of, we have to understand how Io is differentiated or layered to understand how much of the iron or how much of the silicate will reach the surface. For example, much of the iron differentiates as planetary bodies form to the core of that planetary body just because of how dense it is. It sinks down to the core while the body is still molten during formation. This happened on Earth, and this also happened on Io. Its iron sank to its core, and it's actually thought that Io not only has an iron-rich core, but also potentially an iron sulfide-rich core because Io has a ton of sulfur on it in all sorts of forms. And so it could potentially have some sort of iron sulfide or different forms of iron sulfide forming its core. The mantle, however, of Io is thought to be mostly instatite, which is a magnesium-rich pyroxene or silicate mineral, but it's still uncertain in terms of structure whether the mantle is mostly solid, partially molten, or fully molten. So there's a lot to learn about Io's structure, but in terms of composition, it likely has this magnesium-rich pyroxene mantle, and then its crust is all composed of cooled lava that spews from the volcanoes that cover Io's surface. And so we can see here in this image, there's tons and tons of volcanic activity going on, even potentially a magma ocean, which we'll get to in a second. And this lava that cools at the surface forms its crust. And obviously a lot of that lava that forms the crust is not even yet cooled because Io is so volcanically active. But there's a few questions that come along with this volcanism on Io. First off, what is the lava made of? Second off, why? Because you'll see here in a second that it kind of doesn't make sense. Third, how long has Io been volcanically active? And what kind of eruption styles take place on Io? The first question is somewhat easy to answer. Based on our measurements, the lava is mafic to ultramafic in composition. So mafic to ultramafic silicates on Earth are things like basalt to comatite compositions. And these magmas and lavas also contain a lot of volatile content. And in Io's case, the volatiles are dominantly sulfur and sulfur dioxide. And these will play a huge role when we get to eruption styles. So don't forget that sulfur and sulfur dioxide are super abundant as volatiles on or near the surface of Io. Second question is why? So why doesn't a mafic to ultramafic composition of lava erupting at Io's surface make sense? Well, it's because the lava should be more felsic by now due to the eons of episodes of partial melting in the mantle. We talked a lot about partial melting in some of the igneous petrology videos, I guess most notably the silicate magmas video where we talked about partial melting and fractional crystallization and all of that. That is where we talked about how when the mantle partially melts, it produces a more felsic composition in that partial melt because the felsic material preferentially goes into the melt phase, whereas the more mafic material stays behind as solid in the mantle. So after so many episodes of fractionating the mantle, the surface stuff at Io should be pretty felsic. So why isn't it? To answer the why question, we have to answer how long Io has been volcanically active. And there are two possibilities to answering this question. It's either been volcanically active for a pretty short time or a really long time. So first, let's go with the short time and see what that would mean. Well, if the resonance between the Jovian satellite orbits have only relatively recently been developed, then Io might have only recently become volcanically active. So first off, let me go back for a second and say, what does this resonances between the Galilean satellites mean? Well, remember when we talked about tidal heating and how Io is pulled not only by Jupiter, but also by the other moons. The other moons pull Io in a consistent way because their orbits are locked in a resonance where for every revolution that Ganymede makes around Jupiter, Europa makes 2 and Io makes 4. Now, if this locked resonance between the Galilean satellites was developed really early on in their formation, then Io has been heating and been probably volcanically active for a long time, billions of years. But if that was developed only relatively recently, then Io has only been heated enough to be this volcanically active for a short time. And if this is the case, we may be witnessing Io at its peak volcanic activity. This means that Io's mantle has not yet been heavily fractionated yet, and therefore also would explain the lack of felsic material in the lava at Io's surface. However, there's another possibility. Like I mentioned, it could be that the resonances between Io and the other satellites was developed really early on in their formation. If that was the case, Io has been volcanically active basically since its formation, but that would be contradicting the mafic to ultramafic composition of Io's lava. So how could we explain this long-term volcanism without a felsic lava composition? The answer is intermittent activity. So Io could have been volcanically active for so long, but only intermittently. After a long cooling period during an orbital cycle, the onset of heating would be so rapid that the melting of the mantle would create a magma ocean, like we can see in this figure here, that would reset the composition of the mantle to its primitive composition from which the volcanism can begin to stem again. And therefore, if the mantle is reset after every intermittent cycle of volcanic activity, then it would explain the mafic to ultramafic composition of the lava at Io's surface, because it's still relatively primitive in terms of its composition, in terms of partial melting of the mantle. Whereas if it wasn't intermittent, the lava at Io's surface should be really felsic. But timing, structure, and composition aside for a second, what about the style of volcanism on Io? Is it similar to Earth? The answer is yes and no. Io is not similar to Earth in that it doesn't have plate tectonics, so there's not really any spreading center or subduction-related volcanism. But Io does have hotspots, just like Earth. But the hotspot volcanism on Io has a variety of eruption styles, and many are not at all similar to Earth. So let me introduce some of these different styles of Io volcanism, and then I'll tell you a little bit about why they're so different from Earth. First off, there are lava flows on Io that are purely due to the remobilization of volatiles, aka sulfur and sulfur dioxide, near the surface. And so we can see some pictures of sulfur-containing lavas on Earth here, but on Io, this occurs because as silicate magmas ascend through the lithosphere of Io, they interact with and thermally mobilize sulfur and sulfur dioxide in the crust of Io. And so these volatiles then drive not only the eruptions, but then the lava flows at the surface. And sometimes this volatile content, like we talked about in the silicate magmas video, can drive pretty explosive eruptions. Like we can see here, sometimes they're so violent, they cause lava fountaining and lava outpouring. Basically, in these types of eruptions, you have the fountaining first and later the more docile lava outpouring, with lava flows similar to Pahoehoe lava flows on Earth. But another type of lava formation on Io are lava lakes. Lava lakes form, and this is a picture from Earth, obviously, but they can form pretty huge on Io. The last thing I want to talk about, and one thing that I think is really cool, are lava plumes, which come in two main forms on Io. Huge gas-rich lava plumes driven by sulfur volatile content. Here's a picture of one we can see coming off Io's surface, just huge, huge lava plumes that can reach crazy heights. And then the smaller dust-rich type that contains more sulfur dioxide rather than sulfur volatile content and more entrained silicate particles, which is why it's dust rich. But why are these plumes able to reach crazy, crazy heights and even contribute some material to passing by Galilean satellites? Well, it's due to the lack of a very thin atmosphere and lower gravity of Io compared to that of Earth. Because of this, lava erupted from a volcano that would reach 50 meters on Earth would actually reach 38 kilometers on Io. Not 38 meters, 38 kilometers, a crazy scale up compared to that of Earth. And that's because of the gravity and atmosphere. Now, you might be wondering, why does the very thin or lack of atmosphere allow such high-reaching lava plumes? And the answer comes back to what we talked about in the silicon magmas video, when we talked about how the decrease in pressure upon reaching the surface creates the driving process for eruptions on Earth. And the same thing is true for volcanism on Io. Due to the pressure decrease upon reaching the surface, those eruptions become super explosive and reach really high heights. And because on Earth, the atmosphere dampens the pressure difference of when the magma is in Earth versus when the lava is erupting out of Earth, it's still a huge difference in pressure. Obviously, it decreases crazy amount, but on Io, it decreases so much more so quickly that those eruptions can go crazy, crazy high. The last thing I want to talk about is life on Io. The possibility of life on Io is, you guessed it, pretty unlikely, but that's just for life as we know it. There are still two possibilities for life to exist either on Io or because of Io. On Io, weird life could potentially exist, and weird life is just life as we don't know it. I talked about that in the Titan video if you want to check it out, but weird life that behaves and is created and is composed of very different things than we're used to, or I don't know, it's just, it goes by different rules than life as we know it. That could be possible. But the other thing that I think is really cool about Io and life is that life elsewhere could be possible because of Io. And this is really cool because, as we talked about in the Europa video, Io's plumes may provide a flux of sulfur-rich materials to other moons that they cross paths with. For example, Europa's sulfur-rich surface is in part due to material from Io. And life on Europa, if present, may harness such compounds and in part be due to Io's flux of material. But regardless, whether Io has life on it, doesn't have life on it, causes life elsewhere, doesn't cause life elsewhere, studying Io is still super helpful in shaping our understanding of what is possible regarding heating mechanisms and active resurfacing processes. So material cycling and resurfacing through the subsurface and surface environment on planetary bodies on outer solar system planets and moons. And like we talked about in the Europa and Titan videos, these resurfacing processes and cycling of materials from subsurface to surface is of key importance for the presence or potential for life on those bodies. And so understanding these mechanisms and studying Io in this way is really important regardless of the potential for life on Io. So that is it for this introductory video about Io, but as you can see in the upcoming videos, I do want to discuss more specifically Io's lava plumes and hot spots, as well as its lava fountains, lakes, and flows. And lastly, the major reference I am using to make this video is the book called Volcanism on Io, A Comparison with Earth by Ashley Davies. And this is a really great book. It kind of not only explains volcanism on Io, but kind of goes into detail about volcanism on Earth as well. And so if you are learning igneous petrology or looking at that playlist, it has really similar and great information about that as well in here. And so all the stuff like partial melting and the stuff we discussed in the silicon magmas video, all in here, everything in here is really, really informative, not only about Io, but also Earth. And really cool to think about the things that are happening on Io. But anyway, this is linked in my description down below if you want to check it out, as well as other minor supporting references. Lastly, if you are still watching this video, I'd love it if you would comment down below for me what you would like me to talk about in upcoming planetary geology and astrobiology videos, because I love this topic and I have a lot of ideas, but I kind of want to hear from you guys what you want to hear about regarding this topic as well. So let me know down below what you'd like to see in future videos, and maybe I can do a video on your suggestion. But that is all I have for you guys today, and thanks so much for watching, and I will see you guys next time. Bye!